Before we go into this street discussion, let's talk about some stats. First off, Oklahoma has one of the highest rates of heart disease deaths, regular heart disease, in the nation. In 2014, over 10,000 people died from Oklahoma side from heart disease alone. And while it's been going down and people older than 75, it's been going further down at a slower rate than people would want and people younger than 75. So there's obviously something going on here that isn't working properly in regards to public health intervention programs. Let's look at another statistic. Education. Oklahoma has defunded education for such a long time, not a long time, but we have cut more from education in the last 10 years than most any other states. As of now, we spend less than $8,000 per student in entire states. While states like, I believe, North Dakota are putting more into education, we're taking it out. So how do we prepare our students for the world when we're not even educating them about the world at large? And finally, the opioid epidemic. Oklahoma is right in the midst of the largest drug abuse epidemic in our nation's history. And in 2016, over almost 900 people died, Oklahomans died from this epidemic. While Oklahomans died less from opioids themselves, methamphetamine to heroin still caused a large issue. So when looking at these three programs, these three issues, there's something going on that isn't really working to solve them. So I thought, we cannot have students look from the sidelines anymore. We should get more involved, we should get more active. And I think, as students, we can not only address these issues using behavioral insights and new social intervention programs, but we can be leaders in solving them on our campus, in our states, and in our nation. Hello, my name is Hussein Ramji, and welcome to PhD. Welcome to the first video. As an introduction, I'm Hussein Ramji. I'm the founding president of PhD. Today we'll be talking about public health and how to get involved. Thanks for coming. Here's our logo. So first off, let's start with some definitions of public health. The first one is from the American Public Health Association. And they say that public health promotes and protects the health of people and the communities where they live, learn, work, and play. So it's essentially an approach to help other people. It's a way of getting things done to make sure everyone's safe. The second definition is from the CDC Foundation, and they say that public health is a science of protecting and improving the health of people and their communities. So this is the first time you see it as a science. One second, I forgot my materials. The last definition is from this dude, he wrote this book. It's actually from this book. He says that public health is an approach that aims to protect, prevent disease, treat illnesses, prolong value of life, and care for the infirm and to provide health services. A really large definition. But these are all getting at the same thing, that public health is more of a practice that seeks to improve the lives of others across the community. So let's get into my own definition. Public health is an active approach to serve society, aiming to not only improve the life and well-being of the local community, but to alleviate the impact of issues that arise and or are caused by that community. So the opioid epidemic is more or less caused by modern medicine. Teenage pregnancy rates going up, more or less caused by inadequate sex education. And education, misinformation about how important it is in our community, things like that. And public health, I view as a really big umbrella approach, an umbrella science to this. Everything falls under public health, and I mean everything. Medicine, education, technology, engineering, innovation, urban development, city planning, politics, public policy, it's much, much more and more. So just rush through that. But medicine falls under public health. You should go see a doctor so you have less chance of getting heart disease, know what your cholesterol levels are. Technology. Apple recently announced their iPhone X, 10. and they have this bullet point that they have no mercury, no beryllium. That all goes back to the community and public health, essentially. So it all falls under this. And there are many issues that the CDC actually has declared as public health issues for the community at large. So alcohol-related crimes, underage consumption, drug DUIs, perhaps deaths and fatal fatalities related to overconsumption, teenage pregnancies and inadequate sex education, We have, Oklahoma has one of the highest rates of teen pregnancy in the nation, and it's only been going up in recent years. It's been plateaued off, but it's still pretty high for a state, you know, for the United States, for Oklahoma. And then food safety, you know, the FDA does their best at trying to prevent E. coli infections in our community, but you know, some of them fall through the cracks. We need to find out why. Infectious diseases, heart disease, and stroke, the number one cause of deaths in America right now. HIV, motor vehicle injury, nutrition and obesity, the overdose, and then tobacco use. So these are all the issues. And the fact that there are still issues means that there are some things not working properly in regards to the social intervention programs that are directed towards them. So there must be something out there that can help us new approach lives. This brings me to behavior economics. These two cognitive psychologists, Daniel Kahneman and Amos Daniel Kahneman and Amos Tversky, Jonathan's not right.
Sure. Cool.
Well, they, in the 1970s, began studying how people behave, why we make decisions, and why we make decisions that we make. And then that led to discovery of cognitive biases and heuristics, which we'll touch on the next slide. But while Amos might have passed away in 1996, Dr. Kahneman went ahead to win the Nobel Prize in Economics in 2002 for his work. And then he wrote this book, Thinking Fast and Slow, which is actually quite a long but pretty good book. And that was released in 2011. So, the Investopedia defines behavioral economics as the study of psychology as it relates to the economic decision-making processes of individuals and institutions. So essentially, why we make decisions we make, how we behave, and then why we act the way we do. So their work actually exposed a lot of biases. First off, the status quo bias. Well, essentially, if it's something's going on, we don't want to change it, right? If there's like something like, it's like your neighbor has a lot of these going, oh, he will stop eventually. It's a status quo, and no one else is doing it. Let's just leave it alone. Loss and risk aversion. We actually hate losing more than we want to win. So that's why I can't get rid of my books from like pre-K, my coloring books, because I don't want to lose it, right? Loss aversion. The penis effects, people might have like suffered from this, especially if you're on a diet. So like, hey, you had one donut, oh, there goes my diet, let me know the donuts now, right? Or like, hey, I was supposed to study at 4 o'clock, it's 4:05, I'll study at 5 o'clock instead. Or no, 6 o'clock, oh crap, you know, it snowballs. Anchoring and availability bias kind of go together. We use what we see and know to define our own decisions further, our future decisions. So say you see like apples are bad for you everywhere, you might actually start thinking that apples are bad for you, they might take the doctor away, but they're good for you, that's why they keep the doctor away. Default bias, kind of like status quo bias, we go for what is easiest, least, the most parsimonious, the most parsimonious path, least effort to get it done, and present-based preferences. We are a very in the present people. We want instant gratification for what we do, and this leads back to bad behaviors, perhaps bad eating, and it just snowballs even further. So Dr. Kahneman and Tversky might have discovered these cognitive biases, but Richard Thaler and Kat Stenson took it a bit further to actually show how you can actually make these, how you can utilize to make public policy change in the form of nudges. So nudges are essentially using behavioral economics, knowing what people do, and then targeting those with new interventions. So this was taken a step further by David Halpern in the UK. He made what was called the Nudge Units, or the Behavior Insights Team.
Yeah.
And they are part of the David Cameron's cabinet, and they've been using nudges to solve issues in the community at large. One word that they targeted was the decrease in organs and organ donation programs in the UK. So, and they actually succeeded in reversing that. I think they're actually in surplus, or not surplus, but having a lot more than they used to. So David Halpern, and now they actually operate not as a part of the government, but as an independent entity. And there are a lot of them sprouting up across the globe, including in the United States, called the SBST, but I believe they are decommissioned after Obama left office. So here are some examples of nudges. What David Halpern did and his team was make the You Want to Be an Organ Donor box the default option. The top box, they check it first, all of a sudden you have more organ donors than you need. Another one that I read about in the books, color coding the food that you eat. So say you put a green light on the salads, put like a red light on the fried chicken, things like that, actually helps people make better decisions. You know, colors are easier than to read in numbers and words. They go to it a lot quicker. It, you know, helps you make better decisions. Putting food at more reachable locations than candy in a food line. This actually occurred, at least somewhere in America, that they put the fruits further down the line in like an elementary school lunch line, and also the kid started losing weight because the candy was, you know, further down the line, their plate was already full, they didn't need any more food, you know, things like that. Another one, putting lines closer together as you approach a turn, making the driver think that they're going faster, and they slow down, so, you know, they don't crash. And probably the weirdest one, perhaps sad but funny and also effective at the same time, putting a sticker of a fly in the urinal causes the least amount of spillage and leakage in bathrooms. People aim towards it, all of a sudden your bathroom isn't as dirty as it used to be. This actually worked, and I don't know, Melchor Mendelssohn actually did this, and I think it's actually worked a lot of places as well. So these are all nudges in their most basic and somewhat complicated forms. So, knowing given what I just told you, do you think that you can combine behavioral economics, nudges, and public health? Or can you literally nudge someone towards healthier behaviors? What do you guys think? You're right. You can indeed nudge someone. Yes, it is definitely possible. So, how to put these pieces together? Where does behavioral economics, public health, here's that book for reference, you guys can see it right there. How do these all come together on our campus? Here, PhD. We as students can become leaders to end collective complacency. We can end what our current problems that we just assumed are, you know, problems forever, like alcoholism, underage consumption, teenage pregnancy. We can focus our efforts on these and perhaps suggest solutions and our policy changes that could actually change the environment at large. And we as students have a lot of potential to do this. I fully believe that we can. What's going on? So we as students can utilize behavioral insights, nudges, to create mock or draft legislation and policy, public policy making, public policy changes to, you know, target and alleviate public health challenges. And as students, we have a lot more power than we might think. I've seen students do amazing things, you know, from freshman year to even senior year, even, you know, fifth years, before we get to college, we do amazing things. We can utilize this power to change what's around us before we reach quote-unquote adulthood and actually come to our problems. And by combining and targeting our efforts towards issues, I think we can actually make a lot of change on our campus, our state, and eventually our nation. And we can make a difference. So, now, PhD. There are a lot of offices open, officer spaces open. The exec committee is pretty chill. We just meet together probably like twice a month to go over things. I mean, it's, you know, pretty standard exec committee positions, but then the consultancies. This is what I'm most excited about. I've been a part of the Oklahoma Group and the ICCEW, or the Ronnie K. Irani Center for the Creation of Economic Wealth. They're both consultancy groups. And I'm gonna combine what I learned from both those groups into public health targeted projects. And I believe we can definitely do it. And I'll definitely help out along the way using what I like to both groups and applying to public health issues. So the goals for this semester is to target at least one issue, and then at the end of the semester give a deliverable, which kind of set of research papers, our recommendations, cold call transcripts, figures, all the other stuff, and perhaps give it to, I don't know, someone on campus or even send to one of the legislatures at the Capitol. And another aspect of PhD is to bring speakers to campus. And I'm bringing these 1 or 2 speakers to campus this semester, hopefully. I'm currently in talks with the dean of the public health school, Dr. Raskoff, and hopefully we get more things going on the road in the future weeks. So, last but not least, I'd like to thank the following people. Dean Kintzel is our advisor. She's an amazing woman. Dean Ray, he's a dean of Honors College, helped introduce me to Dean Raskoff, who is the dean at the public health school, and that kind of got me rolling pretty well. Dr. Becky Barker helped me lots with feedback going back to freshman year, and actually indirectly helped to create this group. Dr. Christina Roberto, who wrote this book, I called her a few weeks ago, she gave me a lot of great insights on how to make this work properly with nudges and public policy combined. The line in Med, I talked to her a lot about freshman year, my sophomore year. She was the CC of Adams Center. She's currently a PhD candidate here. She helped me a lot with how to make this group hit their ground running. Leah Tanner, who's actually an MSPH candidate at Hopkins, I talked to her a lot last semester to talk about how to make this group work, and she gave me a lot of great insights as well. RS Adams Center, Jonathan Kim, who exposed me to behavior economics and all that jazz. Mrs. Coker, Alex Mongar, talked to them a lot about how to, you know, would this group actually work, behavior economics, etc. Lisa Togg and ICCW, the Lisa Carl family, and then last but not least, my family, mom, dad, Aline, and definitely the cats. Can't leave the cats out. So, we as a group have a lot of potential to change campus at large using nudges, behavior economics, and what we know. We can make a change, and we will. Thank you.